Good morning. So wish you a happy and healthy new year, an important year for a lot of you. Good morning. I thought of, you know, I want to do a poll actually. I was just thinking of a poll, but I thought I'll just ask a question. How many banks do come for placements here? What is the number of banks that, you know, what is the intake in banks? Yeah, happy new year. Thank you. Good morning. I hope, you know, all hangover is over of the new year and all are ready for the final leg. You know, placements would start by Jan end and 10 banks, Indian plus others. Good morning. Okay. Roughly how many get into banks, as in 50 or is it less into banking per se, those who go into banking? Good morning. Rough number, if there is anyone from placement committee here. Banks typically pick up how many of our students? 50? 10%? Any number? Any ballpark? 50 plus or minus delta. Okay, so that's like 10%, you know, plus or minus. Okay, so yeah, thank you. Thanks. Same to you. So I think, yeah, that is a good number. So which means, you know, a lot of you who would go into banking or allied, say, functions will actually have a lot of utility in understanding about this. So in that context is important as well. Good morning. Good morning. Happy New Year. Okay. So so today we will start with a recap. So since the last time we stopped, the last class, we pivoted into understanding credit risk. We stopped exploring market and interest. We went into something very fundamental to the banking book, which is the credit risk of the counterparty. So we started understanding the conceptual framework per se in the last class, more of discussion. And we said we'll keep all the modeling to today's class. So I apologize, you know, just in the new year, we'll be starting to do with some heavy math and some equations, etc. And we'll solve some problems to begin with. Okay, so the first session, we will understand the models, how to compute the risk of a counterparty, how to put some numbers to it, quantitative methods. We'll derive the unexpected credit loss using some you know, elementary probability theory. And then we will pivot into understanding how Indian banks. So first we'll talk about how banks in general account for credit risk. And then we'll talk how Indian banks does this particular credit risk management in terms of quantitative methods. And then we will go into understanding in the subsequent session, that is the next session, we'll start with the case study on Wellfleet Bank. Okay, so that's how I've planned this particular session. The Merton model, the structural model, I'll discuss it in the next class beginning. That's how I've thought to take the session forward. So let's start with understanding the credit loss distribution, because we said in the last class, similar to market risk, we need to understand how to quantitatively account for the risk of counterparty risk. Okay. So credit loss distribution. This is where we stopped in the last class. We said, you know, a credit loss distribution can be something like this. Okay, where, why is it always like this? I said, you know, it's not symmetric in nature, unlike the case of market risk. It's always like this, because think about it. We are talking about, say, lending. Why is it like this? Okay, sorry, my chat window is hanging. Yeah, why is it not asymmetric? We discussed this, right? Credit loss distributions are not symmetric around zero, okay? Because there is no upside to actually having or booking any loans. You only have downsides. It's zero NPV proposition. If you give 100 people loans of 1 rupee each, there is a chance that, you know, 100 rupees come back to you. But that chance that zero people default is very, very minuscule. And hence, you know, it is going towards zero. And the frequency of, you know, 1% defaulting is somewhere here. The frequency of 2% defaulting is somewhere here. The frequency of 3 people defaulting is somewhere here. You know, so somewhere here is the expected loss. This is called the expected credit loss. Okay, expected credit loss. And we said expected credit loss has to be managed by accounting for provisions. The banks ex ante knows, you know, out of 100 people on an average, how many people will default, you know, in 1 year's time. Okay. How do we know that? Because, you know, you have historical data, you know that, look, even if they have the intent, the capacity may not be there. Some people might lose jobs. Some firms may actually go through distress. And hence, there is an expectation of a credit loss, you know, 1 year down the lane. So that is an expected credit loss. You are expected to control for it even before you give the loans, which means you will price. The expected credit loss is actually priced in. So this you will price in. So in your interest rate that you charge for the counterparty, you will price in the expected credit loss of a particular portfolio or of a particular counterparty. Now, the question is, fine, if this is priced in and provisions are made, that is expected credit loss. Now, there could be a scenario that is our, you know, shock absorber we talked about. It's a non-trivial scenario that, you know, there's a chance that you might actually incur out of 100 loans that you lent, 10 loans go bad. Now, that is called the unexpected credit loss. Okay. So that's a scenario out here. Okay. It's a tail event that out of 100, 10 people don't, you know, pay you back, or maybe 15 people don't pay you back. When does that happen? Maybe, you know, some exogenous shock hits the economy, like COVID-19. In such a scenario, you will have to think about, you know, providing some buffer in your lending decisions to prevent this particular risk. And this particular part is essentially the unexpected credit loss. Okay. Unexpected credit loss, for which you will provide capital. So far, so good. Okay, there is expected credit loss, you're pricing in, and for unexpected credit loss, you are actually providing capital when you actually lend to the counterparty, which means you provide capital and the rest can come from, say, depositors or other source of liabilities, because you are an intermediary per se. Now, the question is how to ascertain this capital. Okay, how do banks ascertain this capital, and how do banks ascertain this expected credit loss? For that, let's start with understanding what is loss. Okay, so I'm going to define loss, or L, as equal to B into the adjusted exposure, or exposure. Okay, adjusted means because during default, you know, the exposure could go up. Otherwise, typically exposure is same as whatever is outstanding. Okay, times the loss given default. Okay, can I say this way? The loss will be equal to B times AE times LGD, where B is a random variable which takes the value 1 with probability PD, and it takes the value 0 with the probability 1 minus PD. So essentially, B is a Bernoulli trial in which there is a default event, that is when there is a probability PD for a default event, and 1 minus PD with a outcome of 0, which means there is no default. Can I write like this? Yeah? Is it okay?
The losses? Sir, can you explain why amount exposure can be greater than the outstanding balance?
No, amount can be greater than the outstanding balance in scenarios where there's a commitment. So think about it, Parth. I've given a line of credit of 1 billion, okay? But that particular entity has drawn only 500 million today. So as far as the bank is concerned, the exposure to that counterparty today is 500 million. But you have already given them a line of credit of 1 billion, which means during the default event, they can actually increase the exposure. Parth, is it clear?
So, but if they default, how can you lend them more?
No, it's not default. Not when they default. Of course, when you default, you will stop the line of credit. You won't give them more. But when the default even happens, although your exposure could have been 500, they might draw down in that line. Unless, if you're given a line. So if it's a clean loan, they can't. If it's a clean loan, they can't. So we took the example of credit cards, right? Last day. Simple example. So you have been given one lakh
yes,
limit.
Sir,
yeah. Yes, you have not really drawn anything. But when you are in distress, you tend to draw more. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that's what we're talking about. That's why it's called adjusted exposure. But typically exposure is whatever is outstanding. Okay. That's why I said adjusted exposure doesn't really make a difference. And so B is a random variable which takes the value 1 with probability PD and value of 0 with probability 1 minus PD. Now, if that is so, what is the expected loss? What is the expected loss? Can someone tell me? What's the expected loss? Assuming LGD is already an LGD bar. It's a random variable also, okay? But we are taking LGD bar, a mean value of loss given default. What is the expected loss? Students of management, students of analysis, students of statistics. What is expected loss? If you're going for a banking interview, typically these could be the kind of questions that can come your way. If you're going into risk function per se. Because that's what they try to ascertain on every deal, etc. quantitatively. And today's case also, you know, proves that. What is expected loss here? What is expected loss? So how do you compute expectation? How do you compute expectation? Probability into the payoff, right? In each state of the world. Yeah. Yeah, PD into AE into LGD. Okay, so PD into AE in this particular case and LGD bar. Okay, we're just taking the mean value of that. Okay, this is the expected loss. Yeah, probability default into AE into LGD. But mind you, this LGD is also a random variable. B is also a random variable. So can I write it this way? Can I write it this way? LGD, I took LGD bar, but LGD is also a random variable, which means I need an assumption to write it this way. Expectation of two random variables is equal to E of X into E of Y. When is that? Can someone tell me? Expectation of XY is equal to E of X into E of Y. When you assume what? Yeah, they are independent. Okay, only when they are X and Y is independent, or covariance of XY is zero. So we are assuming that the probability of default and, or rather, this Bernoulli trial B and LGD, both are actually random variables. Unlike your market risk, there are two random variables. They are independent in nature. So we assume that in the modeling. So this is expected loss PD into AE into LGD. Okay, if you have been given these three parameters, you know, the variables out here, you can actually compute the expected loss. And you are expected to provide or provide provisions for this particular metric. That is your expected loss. Okay. Now the question is, fine, this expected loss is the amount that you expect to lose, and hence you price it in into your interest rate that you charge your customer. How to compute unexpected losses? Can someone throw some light? How will I compute this unexpected losses? How will I compute the unexpected losses? Is it a single sigma? Is it like returns? Of course, you can have the loss distribution and then compute sigma. Otherwise, how to model it? Is it just single variable like returns to compute the sigma? How to compute unexpected losses? And this is what, you know, the foreign banks actually do. They compute the unexpected losses using the sigma. It's not easy modeling. So we'll have some limiting assumptions to do that. But in India, regulators have given a workaround, and you know, it's, we use something called a standardized approach to credit risk to compute the unexpected losses. Anyone, how to compute the unexpected losses of this particular distribution using this PD, LGD? What should I do? For unexpected losses, what should I require? From the mean, we are talking about Z value. We are talking about how many standard deviations away from the mean, right? How many standard deviations away from the mean? So I want a sigma. I want a sigma of the what? Sigma of what? Sigma of the B, sigma of LGD. What do I want? Sigma of the losses. Sigma of the losses, right? So how do you compute the sigma of the losses? Let's talk about it. So sigma of the losses is what I want. That is essentially variance of the losses. I want the square root of variance of the losses. Now, how do I compute the variance of losses? Can I write variance of loss is equal to expected value of L square minus expectation of L, the whole square? Can I write it this way? Can I write it this way? Is it okay? Variance of any random variable is expectation of that random variable square minus expectation of the random variable, the whole square. E of X square minus E of X, the whole square. Yeah, you've learned that in first year. Yeah, great. Now, let's try to understand this particular point. What is L? So let's compute E of L square. Okay, E of L square. That is expectation of, sorry, what is loss? B square times AE square times LGD. I'm calling this some bar square. Okay. Now, what is the expectation of B square? Can someone tell me what is the expectation of B square? A Bernoulli trial with probability PD and probability 1 minus PD. What is the expectation of B square? B takes a value 1 with the probability PD, and it takes a value 0 with the probability 1 minus PD. What is the expectation of B square? I'm starting with some, you know, PD itself, exactly. So I would take E of B square times exposure. As exposure, I'm assuming it to be 1, okay? I'm assuming it to be 1, so I'm taking it out of the equation. And expectation of LGD bar square. Okay, this is what you get. And expectation of B square, like Parth mentioned, is equal to PD into expectation of LGD square. Okay, you can call it bar or any non-trivial value there. So PD into expectation of LGD square is expectation of loss square. I also know expectation of loss already. I've already computed. So I'm going to plug that in the equation. Variance of loss is equal to PD into expectation of LGD square, okay, minus E of L the whole square. So that is PD square times LGD bar square. Okay, this is what I get. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to add and subtract PD into E of LGD square minus PD into expectation of, plus PD into LGD bar square minus PD square into LGD bar the whole square. Okay, I just added these terms, added and subtracted these particular terms. This PD into LGD square. Can someone tell me what is this particular term? If I take PD common out, I will get PD, okay, into expectation of LGD square minus LGD bar the whole square. What is this? This is variance of LGD. Can I write this as variance of LGD? Because it's expectation of LGD square, exactly. Variance of LGD. And here I will take PD outside plus PD into 1 minus PD into LGD bar the whole square. Okay. Now this is variance of LGD you mentioned. PD into variance of LGD. Okay. Plus what is PD into 1 minus PD? Isn't it variance of Bernoulli trial? Isn't it the variance of Bernoulli trial? What is the variance of Bernoulli trial? P into Q. Yeah. So that is equal to variance of the Bernoulli trial or variance of the PD measure, okay, into LGD bar the whole square. LGD bar, which is the loss given default, the whole square. Which means I got the variance of losses. I got the variance of losses using this particular formula. Okay. And hence, I can find out the sigma of losses is nothing but square root of PD into variance of LGD, okay, plus variance of the Bernoulli trial, okay, plus variance of the Bernoulli trial times LGD bar the whole square. Okay, this is what your sigma of losses is. So now if you know the sigma of losses, okay, based on the Z statistic, you can compute the unexpected losses. Okay. But the tough thing is, how can you ascertain? Is it normal distribution? Is it a normal distribution when it comes to losses? We discussed this yesterday or in last class. Is it a normal distribution? So how many times sigma should be the unexpected losses? How many times sigma should be the unexpected losses? 2 sigma, 1.96 sigma? Is it so trivial? Is the mean 0? Okay, so there needs to be some kind of assumption to make to arrive at the unexpected losses. So unexpected losses for credit risk. Okay, so there is this Ong's. Okay, there is a person who derived this Ong's unexpected losses. Says 1 sigma is typically the unexpected loss that you can take, which will roughly cover 95% to 90% of the distribution in a binomial setting. Okay, so what you're talking about is something like this. Okay, this is your expected losses. From here, if you move 1 sigma, you will be somewhere in the unexpected losses territory. And that is how much of your capital that you have to set aside based on 1 sigma. So unexpected losses is typically taken as 1 sigma as a limiting assumption. Okay. But if you actually model it, you can get the distribution and then ascertain how many sigmas away from the mean is actually the unexpected loss point. Okay. To calculate the capital adequacy of a particular bank. Now, is this okay, all of you, what we just did? Is this okay? Is that derivation okay? I know it is a bit, not required. I mean, some people are not interested at all in these derivations, etc. But it's important to understand how we arrive at certain things. And we make the assumption that both the probability of default and LGD is independent of each other. And that's how we arrived at this elegant formulation. Now, let's take some numbers to actually solve this, to arrive at what the expected loss is and what the unexpected credit loss is for a particular counterparty. Okay, this we covered in the last class. This is just narrating what we just mentioned in the board. Can we start with this question? Yeah, Sarvesh, yes, there is also correlation between LGD and B. There's non-trivial correlation. That those things is typically a bit more advanced level of modeling. It's called some ASRF framework, asymptotic, you know, risk function. So that is not really, you know, covered here because it becomes extremely mathematically tedious. So what is given to you is the central bank, or the not central bank, rather the Basel has actually given us some framework to actually model based on an internal risk-based or internal rating-based approach, where you have to feed in the PD. PD you can compute based on your past data, etc. PD you can compute. The loss given default rules you can compute, which is based on your recovery rate, past recovery rate. And based on this, you can actually feed into this particular model, which will be a bit more advanced compared to what we derived, okay, which takes a non-trivial correlation between these two metrics. And that particular framework will give you the, will give you the capital adequacy. Yeah, so which one says 11.25? We'll just solve this in the board, in the Excel as well. Parth also got the same answer. So I guess this should be the case. Okay, so secured loan. Okay, so the principal amount, principal outstanding is 5 million. PD is given to you, 3% chance of default. LGD is, sorry, what has been given to you? Recovery rate. Recovery rate is given to you, which is equal to 25%. So LGD is nothing but 1 minus recovery rate. Loss given default is nothing but 1 minus recovery rate. Okay. And that is equal to 1 minus 25%. Okay. So if you are required to hold a credit reserve, which means you are supposed to calculate the expected loss of this particular loan outstanding or loan exposure. So expected credit loss of this particular exposure would be equal to 5 × 3 × 75%, which is 11.25. Okay. 11.25. Okay. Is this clear to all of you? Yeah. Is this fine? Where do you get this 3% from? Where do you get this 25% from? Where do you get this PD measure from? 3%. 3% chance. Yeah, this is a firm. Okay, so you're talking about the ratings, or it could be, you know, structural models, which we'll talk about in the next class, or it could be based on past data that you have in your book. Okay, similar rated firms, similar benchmark firms have a certain probability of default, and you got that 3%, and 25% also comes from your past information, which we talked about in the last class, how to get the LGD and the PD metric. Simple question to start off with. Okay, this is done. This part was done in the board. Okay, so can we do this now? A bank has booked a loan with a total commitment of 50,000, of which 80% is currently outstanding. The PD is assumed to be 2% for the next year, 1 year probability of default, and LGD is estimated at 50%. The standard deviation of LGD is given to you 40%. Drawdown on default is assumed to be 60%. The expected and unexpected losses for the bank are, is the question. I will just put it up here so that, you know, people who were reading the question. How will I approach it? Total commitment is 50. Okay. Outstanding today is 80% of this particular commitment that I've given. The PD expected is 400, says Parth. Let's see. PD is 2%. LGD is given to you 50%. Okay. So expected losses. Okay. Expected losses what? PD into LGD into adjusted exposure path. So what is adjusted exposure? Adjusted exposure would be equal to 40 plus in default, we are assuming 60% of the undrawn amount to be drawn also during default. Okay. So that is also expected. So 60% of 50 minus 40. Okay. So that is 46 is my adjusted exposure. What is my expected losses? 46 into 2% into LGD. Okay. 46. Okay. 460,000 would be my expected losses. Parth, is it okay? All of you got this, what we just did, how I got the adjusted exposure. See, either you give a response in the chat window if you have done, or you switch on the video and, you know, give me a nod of a head. Otherwise, I'm just talking. I can just record my video maybe over a Sunday and you can deliver it. Okay. That also can be done. Look, I am also on this side. Okay. There should be some empathy. Okay. So,
sir, how do they come up with that 60%?
Sorry, Sharon, go ahead.
How do they assume 60%?
Sharon, I can't hear you.
To calculate it. How do they assume 60%?
How do you assume 60%, Sharon?
Yes, yes.
How did you assume 60%?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So 60% is also based on your past data. So what happens is in a default event, you know, the best you can do is you will try to deter the customer from drawing down the lines. One is to limit the lines, okay? Or, you know, renegotiate or maybe ask for more security. These are ways in which you will try to stop the drawdown during a default event. So we are saying we are expecting, right? Because ex ante we have to plan. So we are saying that based on past data during a default event, we have seen customers drawing down up to 60% on an average. That is also based on your past data that you've got the 60%. Okay. So these are all imperative that you should have data to get these numbers. Otherwise, you start with an expert model. Sharon, we discussed last time, right? So conservative is that they will draw down the entire thing. So it will go to 50-50, entire 50 commitment, which means I'll have to price higher. Yeah. Is it okay, Sharon?
Okay, sir. Got it.
Great. Okay. Okay. Now, what about unexpected credit losses? Unexpected losses. And we said unexpected losses is assumed to be 1 sigma. For that, I need to get the sigma. Let's compute the variance. Variance of losses. Variance of losses, we derived it as PD times. Okay, so what is the variance of LGD? Let's compute that. Variance of LGD is what? What is the variance of LGD?
Sir, it's given, right? 0.4 square.
Standard deviation is 0.4. Okay, 0.4 square is given to you. Okay. So variance of losses would be how much? PD into variance of LGD plus, okay, variance of PD itself, variance of Bernoulli trial itself. That is how much? PD into 1 minus PD. That is this into 1 minus PD, okay, into LGD square. Okay, this is your variance of losses. So sigma of losses will be square root of this. So into the adjusted exposure. So 4.14 is the unexpected credit losses. So when I lend to this particular customer, I will have to set aside 4.14 million as a capital. Rest of 45.86 million can come from others' pockets. Okay. Or rather, so 46 is the exposure that I'm expecting. Yeah. So 4.14 should be the capital. Rest can come from depositors' money in terms of the exposure that I take on this particular counterparty. Is it clear to all of you how you apply what we just mentioned? Is it okay? Any doubts here so far? Yeah. So we are assuming 1 sigma away from the mean. So unexpected losses, you have to provide for it, which means you will price. And the unexpected losses is where you provide cover for, or the first line of defense when a bad event happens with a non-trivial probability. Okay, so that is done. Yeah. A bank has booked an unsecured loan with total commitment of 50 crores. The PD is given to you 1.5% for the next year. The expected and the unexpected losses for the bank are? PD is 1.5%. What is LGD? What is LGD?
100%.
It's an unsecured loan. Yeah. So my expected losses would be PD into LGD into commitment. And what about unexpected losses? What is the variance of LGD or variance of losses? Will be how much? PD into variance of LGD. Is there a variance of LGD? It's always 100%. So variance is zero of the LGD. So there is no first term. What you have is the second term, PD into 1 minus PD into LGD square. LGD square is nothing but 1. And hence variance of losses is this. Okay, unexpected losses would be square root of this times my commitment. Okay, 6.07 will be my capital requirement as far as this particular exposure is concerned, because it's unsecured in nature. Yeah, is it clear to all of you what we just did? Yeah, we use the same formula to arrive at unexpected losses. Since variance of LGD is not there, it's an unsecured clean facility that you've given, and hence there is no collateral backing up the claim. So which means, what is the learning from this? We had same commitment roughly 50 and 46. Okay, what is the learning from this? Where do you have more capital requirement? 6.08, yeah, compared to 4.14 unsecured, right? So if you give a clean facility, you are at more risk, and hence you have to provide more capital. More capital means it's more costly for the bank to raise capital. So you'll actually charge higher for unsecured loans as compared to a secured facility. So these are all learnings from how capital adequacy actually stifles banks to actually lend and, you know, commensurately provide adequate buffers. Okay. Great. So that is also done. Simple question. Okay. Next one. Bank has a basket of 500 bonds with similar residual maturity. Okay. All are, say, on the run bonds. Okay. Probably new ones. The exposure of each bond for each bond is 500,000, which is 2% probability of default. The recovery rate expected equal to 0%. Let's assume it is unsecured bonds that you have, say, like NCDs. Okay. There is a 5% probability that at least 25 bonds go to default. Calculate the expected loss and the 95% credit value at risk. Okay. This concept of credit value at risk, I covered that in the distribution in the last class, although I didn't really emphasize it. So what is that? There is a 5% probability. Okay. A bank has a basket of 500 bonds. Each bond has 500,000 exposure. There's a 2% probability of default for each of these bonds. The recovery rate expected is equal to 0%. There is a 5% probability that at least 25 bonds go to default. Okay. Calculate expected losses, loss and 95% credit value at risk. How would you compute it? And can you compute the unexpected losses also from this particular metric? Okay, I'll give time so that, you know, some of you are at least trying to do it. So I'll just write the inputs. Number of bonds is 500. Exposure for each bond is 500,000. The PD is 2%. The recovery rate is 0%. And hence LGD is equal to 1 minus recovery rate is 100%. Okay, so with this, can I get the expected losses? Straightforward, right? Number of bonds into the exposure of each bond times PD into LGD. Okay. So this into this gives me the expected losses from this particular portfolio, okay, of bonds that I am holding. What about unexpected losses? What about credit war? There's a 5% probability that at least 25 bonds will go to default. So what does that statement mean? What does the statement mean? Is that a outlier scenario that is given to you? So there is 95% chance that less than 25 bonds will go to default. Yes or no? Can I rephrase? Which means 95% VAR is directly given to you. So if 25 bonds go to default, that is by 95% VAR limit. Okay, there is a 5% probability that simultaneously 25 bonds will go to default. So my 95% VAR limit, is given to you in an explanatory manner. It's not really mathematical, just told to you that there's a 5% chance that 25 bonds will go to default. So 25 into 500,000. So my 95% VAR limit is equal to 12.5 million. Okay. So 95% VAR limit is equal to 12.5 million. What about unexpected losses? Is there a relationship between expected loss, unexpected loss, and credit value at risk? So credit value at risk typically is this particular. I'll just show it to you from the diagram that we drew. Credit VAR is essentially this part, this much. The entire thing out here is the credit value at risk. This is called the credit value at risk. Okay. Now we have been told that this credit value at risk is 12.5 million. The expected loss is computed as, I don't know how much we computed. It was, 5 million, right? Yeah, 5 million. Okay, 5 million. And hence the unexpected losses would be the difference between these two. The difference between the credit value at risk and the expected losses. So the unexpected losses would be 7.5 million. So you'll actually provide capital to the tune of 7.5 million for this exposure. The 5 million will come from the pricing, and that is how you would actually structure this particular risk quantification of this particular exposure. Okay. Okay, so that is also completed. Sorry. What about this one? Consider default at year T of an exposure of 1,000 rupees. The exposure is 1,000 rupees. That's a default. The first recovery is obtained 1 year after the default for an amount of 300 rupees, while the legal cost and internal cost are charged at the end of the year for that year is 100 rupees. Okay, so you're getting 300 in terms of, say, cash flows. You have repossessed the asset because that belongs to you now. The counterparty has defaulted. Okay, you have repossessed the asset. The asset is going to give you 300 rupees in the first year. But you'll incur 100 rupees in terms of legal and running cost. The default is closed after 2 years with a recovery of 320 rupees and cost of 50 during the second year. For a discount rate of 5%, the loss given default is how much? For this particular exposure. Can we compute it? Exposure is 1,000. Okay. My cash flows, okay, expected 0, 1, 2. Okay. Inflows, outflows. I have 300. I have 320. I have outflows expected of 100 and 50. During the exposure. Net inflow 564 says PARTH. Loss given default. So this is my
answer.
So present value of the expected cash inflows is equal to PV, or rather NPV. 5% is the discount rate of these. Okay. So 435.37 is the expected value of the inflows. So my loss given default, or losses given default, is essentially 1,000, rather this minus this, okay, my LGD will be how much? 56%, right? LGD, loss given default, if you want, yeah, you're right, 64 is roughly 56.46%. Yeah, correct. That's what you just arrived at. And this is typically how the banks ascertain LGD. So SBI chairman had mentioned in an interview, I think 1 year back or something, that their average recovery rate is roughly 43% or 45%, okay, of all the exposures. I think that should have improved probably after the IBC also. Okay. But overall, India average is around 26, was 26, now it has gone up after the IBC in terms of overall recovery rates. Okay. Now we'll go towards market implied credit risk, how to compute the PD or LGD from market implied yields. A simple example or simple question to demonstrate that. Risk-free rate is 5% per year and the corporate bond yield is 6% per year. Assuming a recovery rate of 75% on the corporate bond, what is the approximate market implied 1 year probability of default of the corporate bond? Can someone calculate and tell me? I'll wait. How will you approach it? We said any rate out there in the market has two components, compensation for waiting and compensation for bearing the risk. As far as bond is concerned, the risk that you're bearing is the credit risk of the bond. Okay. So, you know, 6% is the total yield YTM of the bond, 5% is RF. So, which means risk premium is 1%. Now, the risk premium is actually capturing the credit risk of the bond. And we said for capturing the credit risk of the bond, we will price in expected losses, expected credit loss. So, based on these two inputs, can you compute the PD? This is how, you know, Bloomberg, etc. provides the synthetic PDs and all those stuff. Even though there is no credit default swaps, you know, you get the CDS spreads, you know, by synthetically arriving at the PD measures based on the bond yields, even when there is no CDS available for that particular bond. Can we compute it? Point 04 says a week. So RF is given to you 5%. The bond yield is 6%. So the risk premium for a bond, it's essentially default risk premium is yield minus RF. Okay. Recovery. Okay. We are getting 4% across board. So that is good. The recovery rate is 75%, which means my LGD is equal to 1 minus of 75, 25%. What is the approximate PD? So we said expected credit loss is priced in. And for a $1 exposure to this particular bond, my expected losses is essentially given by PD times this particular LGD, that is 25%. Okay. And hence my PD would be implied. That should be the risk premium that is charged for 1 divided by 25%. Is essentially 4%. So you got the probability of default from the traded value, traded YTM of the particular bond in the market. Is it clear to all of you? Is it clear what we just did? Yeah. So which means even if you have the bond information, you can eke out the probability of default from the bonds. Okay. When it is a junk bond, the yields actually skyrockets. So based on that, based on these measures, you can actually eke out a PD measure from the market implied rates. So if you know that active market is out there, you can always eke out the PD measure. And we can, if you know the PD, then you can ascertain your unexpected credit loss also from these values. Okay, that's how banks model their internal rating based metrics. Is it clear to all of you this one? Simple problem. Yeah. Okay, and the last question on that is this. The spread on a 1 year BBB rated bond, what is so significant about BBB? Is there any significance of BBB or is just the BBB? In the last class, we mentioned something, right? What is significant? Yeah, BBB minus and above is the investment grade category. So there is a discontinuity around that particular rating. okay, related to the risk-free treasury rate, similar to maturity is, with a similar maturity is 2%, which means the spread that you're charging on the bond is 200 bips. It is estimated that the contribution to the spread by all non-credit factors, okay? So sometimes while I mentioned that all risk premium can be ascertained to default risk, it is not necessarily the case. Sometimes there can be other non-credit factors, example, liquidity risk, okay? Yeah, parts, that is the assumption. So theoretically, entire 1% will be ascertained towards or attributed towards default risk. If everything was theoretically correct, then the bond will only have the default risk, okay? But in nature, there will be also liquidity risk based on the term structure of the bonds, etc. There could be liquidity risk in unwinding that particular position. And hence, these also get priced in. So that's what this particular example gives you. If there is no friction, theoretically, the entire risk premium should be default premium only. Okay, but empirically, you see that other frictions also get in. And we are saying that based on that frictions, out of this 2%, 0.8% can be attributed to those factors. So which means purely credit risk factor is 1.2%. Okay. Now, if it is 1.2%, can you compute the default probability of the bond? Can we do that? So in a very advanced market, say like the US and very liquid fixed income markets, you can say the liquidity risk is actually negligible. But say for in India, where you don't have active fixed income markets, the liquidity risk is a non-trivial amount, which means you need to compute or account for it as well when you actually price the bond or when you eke out the PD measure from this particular bond. So you know the spread is 2%. The premium in the spread due to non-credit factors is 0.8% or 80 bips. So which means my default spread is equal to 2 minus 0.8. My LGD is given to me as 60%, and hence my PD will be simply 1% divided by, is it 1? 60%. Okay, I think, yeah. You all got this answer, 2%? Yeah, great, fair. So this is also done. Okay. Now, so we got a gist of how to compute the losses, right? How to compute the expected losses, how to account for the capital. So that is how the banks actually ascertain the credit risk of a counterparty, and they have to provide capital commensurate to this. So these are the metrics. So we learned the concept, we learned the model, and we learned the quantitative aspect of credit risk in terms of how the banks arrive at the capital adequacy for a particular counterparty just based on credit risk. Now we will get into some practical relevance in India. Okay, so this is predominantly in the West where you actually use advanced credit model, advanced credit risk management models, or the internal rating based approach is what you just learned. Okay, but in India, okay, what RBI has done is RBI has not permitted any bank to actually do any internal rating based capital adequacy provisions. Which means you can do internal rating. You can arrive at your PD measure based on your metrics, based on your past data, etc. But in order to calculate the capital adequacy of a particular counterparty, okay, you cannot use that particular PD measure. You have to use something which is prescribed by RBI based on the standardized approach to credit risk as per Basel norms. Let's see. Let's understand how that is arrived at. Okay, you look at the theory behind it. So we talked about Basel regulations earlier in an earlier class. It's a convergent regulations to improve the risk management framework within banks. It's applicable across countries, across geographies, this particular measure or method. And the regulatory change that happened between Basel 1 and Basel 2, as far as credit risk is concerned, which continued in Basel 3, is that, you know, capital requirement is now sensitive to the risk of the exposure. Earlier, under Basel 1 regime, okay, every counterparty, okay, got a certain risk weight, which was one size fits all. But after Basel II, it became risk sensitive. So based on the counterparty's risk, you have to provide capital. Okay, I'll take example to make you understand what has happened. Okay, let's look at the change in the regulation. So earlier in Basel I, irrespective of whether you are AAA rated or CCC rated, all of the counterparty would incur 100% risk weight. When I say 100% risk weight, what does it mean? I will take numbers and simple example to explain to you that. Okay, whereas in Basel II and commensurate in Basel III, what change happened is that this became sensitive to the risk of the counterparty, which means if you lend to Reliance vis-a-vis you lend to a a counterparty which is CCC rated, the risk weightage that you would have to incur is lower. Okay, there is a change. Of course, it is based on the counterparty's credit worthiness. Now, this change was huge. Okay, this happened in 2008 in India, and as I told you, this was the time when credit ratings also picked up in India because banks had to ascertain the counterparty's risk using external credit ratings in India. So six rating agencies were empaneled, or rather given the approval at various stages. Four were initially given, and then at various stages the others also came in, and based on the external credit rating of the counterparty, the bank will have to provide capital, okay, when they take exposure on a particular counterparty. Let's try to understand how they do that. So the minimum capital as per Basel regulations and what RBI has prescribed, or for any jurisdiction for that matter, can be ascertained using risk weight times the minimum capital adequacy ratio of the country. So for RBI, it is 9%. Okay, for India, we have taken capital adequacy ratio as 9%. Okay, for say, I'm going to take an assumption of 10% for the sake of easy computation. Okay, times the exposure. So risk weight times the minimum capital adequacy ratio times the exposure should be your capital that you have to set aside when you take exposure on a counterparty. I'm assuming a car, a capital adequacy ratio of 10%. Okay. Let's assume under Basel I regime, Reliance came to SBI and sought a 100 crore facility. If Reliance came to SBI and sought a 100 crore facility, SBI can give that facility subject to 10 crore of their own capital and 90 crore comes from other depositors. Yeah, is it clear to all of you? That is the level of capital. Why is 10 crore, where is 10 crore coming from? Risk weight is 100% because it is one size fits all in Basel I regime. One size fits all. So 100% risk weight for every counterparty. 100% times 10% times 100 crores. Is it clear to all of you? That is 10 million. So 10 crores. 10 crores have to be your own capital. Rest 90 will come from other source of liability. Now under Basel I, if a CCC rated firm came and approached SBI, say Jet Airways, you know, when it was defaulting, it is CCC rated, and they also sought 100 crores. SBI will have to set aside the same 10 crores. Why? Because irrespective of the counterparty, the regulations told only 100% risk weight for any counterparty. So they have to set aside same 10 crores and the rest 90 crores can come from other source of liability. Now, what changed is under Basel II. Under Basel II and then continues even today under Basel III is that if Reliance comes to you today and seeks 100 crore exposure, then SBI will have to set aside only 2 crore in capital vis-a-vis 10 crores. Why? Because the risk weight of Reliance is triple rated entities will incur a 20% risk weight. So 20% times 10% times the exposure is your capital adequacy. Because the 2 million can come from your pocket or should come from your pocket. Rest 98 can come from cheaper source of liabilities like depositors. Is it clear to all of you? Is it clear to all of you this part? Is there a problem? Any doubts so far? How the banks work, or how the banks set aside the creditors' capital, weighted capital. No book will give you this. Okay, so I'm just trying to give you a toy model. Okay, great. So under Basel II, if a CCC rated firm came, however, now the risk weight, okay, is tiered, it is 150%. So 150% of 10% of 100, that is 15 crores of capital, have to come from your pocket, 85 from other source of liability. Now you tell me what will happen to these firms after Basel II is implemented. Or today when the bank underwrites a AAA rated firm and CCC rated firm, what will they think about these firms? Bank has a cost to it, cost to doing the business with these two firms, incremental cost. Expected losses is pricing. Okay, that is for provisions. We are talking about capital to for account for accounting for unexpected losses. Expected losses pricing. Pricing clearly will be higher for CCC rated firm. Okay, compared to AAA rated firm, both the regimes. Okay. Yeah, there is standardized risk weight a week. That's why I just showed you that particular figure gives you the standardized risk weights. 20, 50, 75, you know, 100, 150. There is a prescribed risk weights given by RBI based on the credit rating of the counterparty. Is it clear to all of you? Similarly, banks. If I'm taking an exposure on banks. So if other counterparty bank is AAA rated, then I have to set aside only less weight. If the counterparty bank is actually lower credit, less credit worthy, then I'll have to set aside more capital. Is it clear to all of you what I'm trying to say here? Any doubts? What is the implication of this? This particular regulatory change. So in India, no one computes unexpected losses. Okay. No one computes a sigma of losses, which I did for you in the class. They just account for unexpected losses by taking the prescribed standardized risk weights that RBI has given. And this particular buffer will act as the shock absorber. They don't really compute the unexpected losses because, you know, they can't really change this. This might be a conservative estimate. Okay, this might be actually conservative. So what are you trying to say? Okay, there is only 2% chance that the risk Reliance would actually default. You know, the worst case scenario, when things go bad, when things go south, maybe there is only 1% chance that, you know, Reliance will lose by, or sorry, not 1% chance, 2% chance that Reliance will lose you money. Whereas there is a 15% chance that a CCC rated firm will actually go bad in a worst case scenario, like in COVID. In a normal scenario, whatever is the risk, the credit risk of a counterparty that you account for in the pricing, okay? Pricing of that particular exposure. Now, what is the implication of this particular change? Just a toy model, I put it. Is there an implication? Can you draw something from this? Exactly. Yeah, Vidya is correct. Yeah. So if you're actually, one is, of course, higher rating, better the benefits for the bank. Okay. So the firms also have increased their rating shopping. Okay. Because banks will dissuade firms with lower ratings to take on board. Okay. Because they'll have to provide more capital. Capital is expensive, especially for Indian banks, especially for Indian public sector banks. Okay. Where did public sector bank get their capital from? Where do you get this capital from? I just talked about all this capital. Where do you get the capital from? What are the source of capital? What is the source of capital? Where do public sector banks get their capital from? Equity and profits. Sarvesh, do they make really good profits in the last 5-6 years? Yeah. So where do they get the capital from? RBI gives capital. Then we have something wrong. RBI is the owner of the banks. Generate new currency. Seriously, capital. RBI gives capital to banks. Students of finance, who gives capital to banks? Who's owning the bank? Who's bringing capital? We're talking about equity capital here, right? Who's owning the bank? Government. So taxpayers' money has to come in. Government has to infuse. And that is the biggest debate, right? You have been infusing equity after equity every year since 2008 into this Allahabad Bank and, you know, all these banks which are going down, okay? Really huge equity infusion that has come from taxpayers' money, and they've been bleeding losses. And when losses happen, you'll have to infuse equity. Why? Because otherwise, what is the other option? If you don't infuse equity by government, what will you have to do? You have exposure already in the bank, in the asset side. You're already exposed. You already have exposure. You'll have to provide capital adequacy. You'll have to provide capital. If you don't have capital, enough capital to provide for the losses, they cannot lend. Fair enough. Karthikeyan, that's a consequence. But what will you do to shore up capital if government is not giving you capital? Profits anyway, forget it. You're running losses. Government is not providing capital. So what will you do? You can issue capital in the market. You can raise equity in the markets. Yes or no? Hello, students of finance. Yes or no? But have public sector banks come into the market to raise equity? What is their book to market ratio? What's a book to market ratio? Book to market ratio is extremely high. Market to book is 0.8, which means what? If you come into the market will price you cheaper. They won't get the necessary capital. Okay. If you raise the equity in the markets, market actually discounts a lot of this value of these banks, especially public sector banks. SBI is really good, 0.8, but some of them are at 0.4, 0.3, etc. You know, so there is no point in coming into the market and raising. So what do? They try to do private placements. Yes or no? QIPs. Yeah, you would have seen that during COVID period. I mean, you have to relate all this stuff to what is happening on the ground also. So capital is extremely costly. So you can raise money from the capital markets, maybe through private placements. Else what? Even if private placements also is not possible, what will you do? How will you raise capital? You'll have to sell your assets, sell your prime assets, and then reduce your balance sheet size. You cannot have exposure. That's the worst case. The consequence is that you'll have to sell your assets and raise capital, or rather reduce the exposure on the counterparty. Now, is it clear to all of you how capital is actually material as far as the banks are concerned? Otherwise, their operations comes to a standstill, irrespective of SBI, ICICI, Citibank, JP Morgan. Unless you have capital, your operations will come to a standstill. If Reliance comes and asks you 100 crores, unless you have 2 crore in capital, you cannot lend to them. Okay, which means you need to keep some buffer in terms of capital adequacy. You should either run profits to replow the capital, replow the reserves, or increase the reserves, or you have to probably raise capital from elsewhere to lend to these counterparties. Is it clear to all of you how capital adequacy is implication? Yeah, one is that rating shopping will go up. Any other implication? Now, there was a speech given by Raghuram Rajan in 2015 in Kafral, okay, which talked about the fact that these regulations are stifling the banks in emerging markets. Why do you think he made that statement? This is actually stifling the banks in emerging markets to, you know, it's actually a this convergent regulation. That is, a regulation is the same regulation is applicable in the US, same regulation is applicable in Japan, same regulation is applicable in India. He made a statement that, you know, Basel regulations, while it is in the best interest of financial stability by providing adequate capital, it stifles emerging market countries like India. Why? What will happen? What behavior will you see from banks when these regulations come in? Can I make a statement that all banks behave alike nowadays because of these regulations? There is hardly any differentiation possible. Everything is very structured. Loans will not be given to lesser creditworthy borrowers. They will try to cherry pick the best customers. Okay. And when the growth happened in advanced economies, there was a credit fuel growth. Now, the credit uptake, you know, banks also will be extremely risk averse to give credit because of the capital adequacy norms and this manner. So in such a scenario, emerging markets are stifled by whatever standards are applied to the advanced economies. Same argument prevails even in the climate accord. Okay. The same kind of standards. Okay. Because they will apply the same standards for every country, irrespective of what the stage of growth is, especially in banking. And hence, you might actually stifle the less credit worthy borrowers by saying that, look, for us, the capital requirement is higher, so we will not give you loans. Either reduce the exposure to you or charge you higher because our capital is costly for us. So you get that, right? Which means the less creditworthy borrowers will get spaced out of the market. They will become extremely financially constrained, and that will actually affect the overall growth in the economy as well. Okay. So these are one problems. Another problem is concentration risk. Every bank will want to lend to AAA rated borrowers. They'll be prime customers. Okay. They will try to take on more and more leverage, more and more debt now, because they are being sought after by all the banks. And that will actually probably increase the concentration risk also on the best borrowers, which means at the expense of stability today, you might actually incur a very, the probability of default might be lower, but the overall losses could be really high because the intensity, when that event happens, if a good firm goes bad, then it can actually have a domino effect in the economy. Is it clear to all of you? Say ILFS, yeah, very highly rated. Yeah, but when it went down, it had a domino effect in the market in terms of how those credit actually had to unfold in the market. Clear to all of you? Any doubts so far in this one? Yeah, great. Okay, so this is the way regulators in India have mandated the credit risk approach. Now, one thing to notice, in the advanced economies, they use something called as internal rating based. That is the model-based approach. Now, what is the problem with the model-based approach? Can you see any problems? Why RBI has not really allowed internal rating based approach in India? In fact, ICICI put up a proposal in 2015, but it was not really approved till date for an advanced method of ascertaining credit risk. Why do you think regulators are not really allowing that method to be imbibed in a particular? Conflicts of interest, Karthikeyan, like what?
A certain company might be preferred over other, whereas having an independent credit rating agency to rate would, to some extent, decrease this.
Okay, so you're saying internally means, you know, they are, but then it's in the bank's interest any which ways, right? Independent agency is giving it, but even today, independent agency has a conflict of interest because the firm getting rated is the one who's paying the fees. So there is a certain conflict of interest, but you're getting an independent assessment. I get that. I take your point, Karthik. But how do you think this is a problem if the bank is...
There won't be any uniformity across the banks.
There won't be any uniformity across the banks, which means they can game it. They can
game it. It'll be difficult to estimate the non-performing assets across in the overall economy level.
So what do you mean with difficulty? They can game it, right? They can game the PD measure. They can game the LGD measure. Okay, what they arrive at, because that's based on past data. Yeah. So a bank might say that, look, I'm taking this big based on convenience, maybe 1 year horizon, maybe, you know, 2 year horizon, maybe 5 year horizon. Okay. So that way, internal rating based has this problem of discretion that has been given to the banks to arrive at these measures. That's one problem. Okay. There is a conflict there because they will try to keep wafer thin capital, right? Because capital is costly. Yeah. So they would want to have less capital for a particular counterparty. So they will try to reduce the measure, PD measure, and commensurately LGD measure to put less capital ex ante when you lend to a counterparty. Fine. What else? So how will you mitigate it? Is there a mitigant? This had actually implications, geopolitical implications. this IRB approach, which the advanced economies were using, especially in the US, compared to European banks, etc. So there are geopolitical risk also. In 2017, the BCBS, the Basel Committee for Banking Supervision, came to a consensus that whatever internal models that you use, whatever prescription that you use, the risk weightage, the risk weight that we took here, 100%, 150 and 20, that risk weight cannot be less than 72.5% of the standardized approach. So you put an artificial floor saying that whatever description that you want to use in terms of your own counterparty, your own models, fair enough, you can use that. But artificially, there is a floor now, which is 72.5% of whatever is prescribed by standardized approach should be the minimum floor that you can go to. So you cannot take even aggressive kind of assumptions for a counterparty. For instance, if a counterparty is rated BBB as per say Moody's, you know, your internal rating could say that it is actually AA+ or, you know, AA-, for instance. That could be an extremely aggressive assumption that one can make based on your performance, based on your counterparty's performance, based on your past performance that you have with them. Okay, so that is where the discretion has been culled. So in India, that particular approach is not allowed. In India, we only follow standardized approach to credit risk. Any other open points with this? We will break here and we'll come back on the case study. Any open points?
Sir, shouldn't CAR also depend on the credit rating?
A capital adequacy ratio is mandated by the particular jurisdiction. So in India, so what Basel mandates is 8% minimum. You cannot be below 8%. Any country cannot choose less than 8% as the capital adequacy ratio in the country. Okay, that is what is Basel prescribed capital adequacy ratio. Now what India has taken is 9% as our capital adequacy ratio. That is a prudence that, you know, RBI has exercised, because 8% is a global average, so to speak. Okay. So we are saying that we are an emerging market, so we should have a higher, capital provision, because we are probably more riskier as compared to, say, an advanced economy. Now, like you said, certainly the capital adequacy ratio also change, but risk weight is already captured in that, no, Parth? When you multiply with risk weight, your capital adequacy ratio is actually changing, right?
Sir, isn't risk weight equivalent to PD and capital adequacy ratio equivalent
combined
to...
Correct. So risk weight is already captured in the fluctuation part. So think about it. For Reliance, it's 20% of 9%. So 1.8%. For a triple C rated firm, it is 150% of 9%. So that's like 13.5%. There is a tiering. You get what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes,
so capital adequacy ratio is fixed. The risk weight is actually changing. And there's a looking back, how should risk modeling have done by lenders in the US during... So Sarvesh, US implemented Basel regulations only in 2009. So this Basel II regulations rather. So they had a one size fits all approach to credit risk when this was happening. Okay. But in the US, what really happened was this risk was not in their balance sheet. Okay. This was not in their balance sheet, to be frank. These are all, you know, packaged into securities, which were off balance sheet, which were derivative securities, etc. Okay. So this is much more complex than what it seems. It is not really credit risk. Yeah, so think about it. If they had kept all these mortgages in their balance sheet, what would have happened? They had to provide enough and more capital, Sarvesh. So what did they do? They packaged it and sold it outside. So they didn't take the exposure on those counterparty. They originated the loans, but they sold it to someone else. Exactly. That is why the risk got transferred, no, Sarvesh? They took immense risk and transferred the risk elsewhere. Yeah, so that's why it was a systemic risk, right? Everyone got affected because of that. They didn't keep it in their particular balance sheet. If they had to keep it in their balance sheet, they would have to set aside 100% risk weight. Because it's mortgages that they originated, not 100%, sorry. Mortgage loans only had 35% risk weight, okay? As per the Basel norms, even Basel I. Putting the risk on those bonds? No, but Sarvesh, they were not holding the counterparty. They originated the loans, but they didn't have the asset in their balance sheet. They were just doing a fee-based business. They originated the loan, they packaged it, and they sold it to someone else. Okay, to other banks, universal banks, you know, so-called Barclays, HSBC, Deutsche Bank, you know, or BNP or Credit Suisse. These are the banks which took it, or maybe Japanese pension funds, Japanese mutual funds, all of them purchased these securities. They were holding those securities. So they had credit risk. So eventually when the mortgage loans or people that defaulted on the mortgage loans, not the US banks, not the US commercial banks, which were the banks that did well during that period? Your Wachovia did well, Bank of America did well, yes or no? During the credit crisis, no, I mean, when I say did well, relatively did well. Am I making sense here? Indian banks, did we have a problem? Did we have a problem in Indian banks? Did we have a problem in Indian banks? Sarvesh, so think about it. I will have credit risk if I'm holding that asset in my balance sheet, right, Sarvesh? Yeah, it was not allowed here. We didn't. We were not, you know, having that exposures. Okay, but Sarvesh, think about it. If I'm holding the exposure in the balance sheet, then I have to provide capital. No, if I give 100 rupee mortgage to Sarvesh, then if Sarvesh defaults, I'll have a risk. Yeah, but I originate. You know, I find out Sarvesh. I find the client called Sarvesh. I give you 100 rupee loan, but I package that 100 rupee loan and sell it to someone else. So that is not within my risk.
No, sir. I got that part. What I'm saying is that the purchases of these bonds, like how did they not evaluate the risk in this case?
So that is where, you know, the question about whether Lehman was holding all this toxic asset and how couldn't they ascertain it? Yeah. So, I mean, the fundamental assumption, if you ask me, was that, you know, the land prices could never go down. The land prices could never go down. So that is a fundamental assumption that, you know, they worked on. The land price will always go up. The conventional argument given was economics. You know, there's always scarcity of land. Land is fixed. Number of people in the number population is going up. So technically, land price can never go down. And in that sense, even if the customer defaults, you can repossess the land and actually sell it for a higher price. Yes or no?
Yes, sir. Got it.
So that is why AIG insured all the CDSs also, right? So you, AIG was betting on the fact that even if the counterparty defaults, I'm actually better off. So see, insurer is always worried about defaults, right? Or, you know, if someone actually comes up with a calamity, they will have to pay the entire amount to the affected counterparty. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah. But if insurer thinks that whatever you get in return as a collateral is actually increasing in value, they don't really care because they think that, you know, even if that outlay is given to them, my asset that I'm repossessing actually is increasing in value. So they didn't, you know, they even underwrote, you know, in a very loose manner. So the risk that they were underwriting was mortgage risk, okay? That land. So they assume that the value of land will always go up. So even if they are going to default on that particular financial security, the underlying real asset will always increase in value. Okay, that is assumption. Even AIG was underwriting all the CDSs, trade defaults, you know, swaps, okay, yeah, using that kind of metric. So they insured that also. So Lehman's of the world were insuring their credit risk with AIG. So AIG was sitting on this massive risk. Like Sarvesh is asking, sir, who is bearing the risk? Yeah, AIG was bearing the risk and they had to be bailed out. They completely went bust. Yeah, they were underwriting all this default risk. Yeah. Is it clear to all of you the chain of events? I don't know. Did I make sense or not in terms of how this actually happened from the real sector to actually even AIG collapsing? I mean, that spirit, you know, it's, we'll talk about Lehman bankruptcy in the next class or the next class as a case study. We will do that. Those who have access to, you know, these content providers, I don't know if you're in your hostels, you have. There is a movie called Too Big to Fail. Have you seen that movie, Too Big to Fail? I mean, user discretion is, of course, warranted because they use all unparliamentary language because bankers are like that. But if it is possible, please watch that movie. So that case is actually that movie itself that has been narrated in the case. It is about how Lehman went about their business and how that collapse happened. So if possible, watch that movie and come in so that the discussion also becomes richer in that particular context. That is in the context of liquidity risk. We'll discuss about that particular episode. And there will touch upon these aspects also. So like you said, India didn't have much of exposure. So we were actually immune to that particular systemic shock that was running across the globe, yeah, to be frank. I think during that time, Dubai had some 90% of all the cranes in the world or something. 90% Dubai that time, 2008, you know, you could flip a property. So in Dubai, you could flip a property. That is, you know, you buy a property, you come out of the agent after signing the deed, you can sell that property and get some 50,000 dirhams. So that is roughly equal to $125,000. Sorry, 12,500, roughly $13,000-$14,000 just by coming out, you know, in that span. That was the kind of, you know, mania that was happening out there. In that context, you also should read this book called Manias, Panics and Crashes by Charles Kindleberger. It is a very, very easy read. I think 100 pages or so, or maybe a bit more, 200 pages or so, but very, very easy read. It actually tracks all the crises since the tulip crisis. And he tries to draw some parallels in terms of how crisis builds up, how this entire crescendo builds up. He argues that it is based on a shock, a positive or a negative shock, that this mania builds up and that translates into a panic and eventually crashes. He tries to draw some parallels and he tries to learn from all the previous crashes in the world. So those who are interested in that, please do take a read of it. That will be actually worthwhile. And also this Too Big to Fail, those who can watch the movie better. Okay. Again, viewer discretion has to be there. The language is a bit more crude. Okay, straight to the point, and I think they depict what the actual scenario was. So we'll come back at 10:45, and we'll start the case on Wellfleet Bank in the spirit of what we discussed in credit risk. we'll resume. So, yeah, one of the thing that Sarvesh mentioned is that, you know, assuming, sir, they lend to the same class of borrowers. Sarvesh, what do you think? They lend to the same class of borrowers? I mean, in hindsight, of course, we have the liberty and the benefits of information and data today. They lend to the same class of borrowers.
They lend to a lot of like borrowers who didn't have reliable income streams, let's say.
Correct. Subprime, right? As they call it. So essentially, you know, those days you had loans with teaser rates. Teaser rates would mean 0% for the first 2 years, and then the rate would kick in, you know, so you didn't have any outlay in terms of interest component in the EMI. Even the principal could have been deferred. All this stuff was happening. Plus they also had something called as ninja loans. Anyone? What is ninja loans?
No income, no job loans.
Exactly. No income, no job, no asset also, you know, when it is not mortgage, sometimes unsecured clean loans, personal loans without even asset also backing it. Okay. So these were the kind of underwriting standards that were there. The reason being that, look, eventually this risk is not sitting in my balance sheet. Why should I bother? You know, like Karthik mentioned, there is a conflict of interest there also. I originate, fair enough. The other counterparty who is sitting in Japan and probably buying the securities is hinging on the, you know, fact that, look, this bank is taking a good measure in terms of underwriting, probably is giving loans to only the best and prime customers. But that is not the case. The counterparty itself was junk. So that actually had a domino effect at a later stage when things went bad. Of course, you know, when the rates were increased by Greenspan, I think in 2004-05, the housing stress actually started to go up. Even 6-7, I think this was evident that the housing stress was the payments. People didn't have money to pay when the interest rates increased. The EMIs increased, and this actually led to, from a real sector, of course, financial sector was exposed. So right now, we think that we have safeguards against this particular risk. I hope, you know, we have kind of covered most of the risk. But what COVID also made us learn is that, you know, which we'll talk about, when it comes to operational risk, there is something called that, and why a bit of redundancy, etc., is beneficial. We'll talk about when we come to operational risk. So I think every event is teaching us something. But that also will stifle business per se. So that is what the conflict of interest or conflicts are in terms of risk management. We'll talk about that in the context of the case today. So I also mentioned about some books, those who are interested in risk per se, those who are going into this particular industry. It is always good to get these perspectives. You know, that book on Charles Kindleberger is a nice read. There's a book by Ricardo Rebonato, a bit mathematical. It's called, you know, Plight of Fortune Tellers. These are all good reads. Of course, Nicholas Nassim Taleb's books are there. Which gives his perspective, Fooled by Randomness and Black Swan. These are all good books to put this risk management framework in a perspective. Okay, because ultimately, everyone is a risk manager, not only risk manager per se. Everyone is a risk manager because you are responsible for the eventual bottom line end of the day. So that way, these are all important, irrespective of whether you are in risk profession or not. And risk profession today, I don't know if you actually do some analysis at the Placecom, etc. But one place, you know, where if you look at, say, Naukri.com or any of those portals and see where the jobs are, even in the West, it'll be predominantly in the risk side of things, even in banks. So this is something which is of a hot topic, a lot of demand in the industry per se for professionals with knowledge of risk and students who understand risk. Risk management frameworks per se. Okay? Eventually, everyone is a risk manager. So that is a given, irrespective of where you are and which domain that you're working in. And this, the best part about this is this particular frameworks are getting fed in to the non-financial institutions also through the impetus on risk management committee, etc. That is also getting fed in. As we discussed, financial risk is not paramount there, but still people are realizing the benefits of having a sound risk management even in non-financial institutions. So that way utility is actually spilling over. We are probably talking about something that will have some long run benefits. Okay. So yeah, in this context, who is going to lead the discussion on the on the case study, risk management at Wellfleet Bank. Who's going to start? What is Wellfleet Bank? Has anyone heard about that bank? What is Wellfleet Bank? Is it a hypothetical name or there's a bank by that name? Headquartered in UK. How many of you are Googling it now? Wellfleet Bank. Didn't hear it. Yeah. It's a fictitious name given by the author. Yeah. It is a fictional name. So Wellfleet Bank, I will spoil the suspense so that we start discussing in that perspective also. Wellfleet Bank is actually Standard Chartered Bank. Okay. This is actually SCB. Of course, the case study, the non-disclosure agreement between the author and the bank would have dissuaded that to be revealed. So it is actually SCB. Okay. Of course, it has huge operations in the emerging markets as compared to advanced economies. Their primary revenue streams are commercial banking. So you have retail and corporate banking, as you can see in the case as well. And even the others are also masked, the names. So which is Usher Industries? I'm sure some of you would know that. What is Usher Industries? What could be Usher Industries? An industry or a firm that went in for a takeover in 2006 in the steel industry, and that to a French company. Yeah. Yeah. Usher is not Arcelor. Yeah. Arcelor Mittal. Yeah, exactly. Zelmond is Arcelor. It's a Mittal group that you're talking about. The Usher Industries is nothing but the Mittal group, and Arcelor Mittal is the merged entity. Okay. So we're talking about Zelmond in the case that is actually Arcelor, the French company, French steel giant. What about GCC? GGC, Mining Corporation. That is also a fictional name. Of course, people are not really, not very used. Rather, in India, we don't have gold mines. We are a net importer of gold. We had coal, acquired it. But gold mining company that we are talking about in this particular case is, I think, Ashanti Goldfields. Okay, that has a lot of operations in Africa. That is the best bet I could see in terms of some correlation with what they have explored, and the revenues that they have given actually matched with the Ashanti Goldfield Mines revenues in 2007 and 8. So these are the protagonists, so to say, the firms under question in this particular case. So who is going to start the case? What is the case about? What is the friction? Who are the protagonists in the particular case? It's an easy read, so we will keep aside the numbers out for the time being. Okay, if time permits, we will bring it in. But I want to discuss the numbers in the context of RAROC, risk-adjusted return on capital, which I will discuss maybe in the last class. Okay, so that part we can probably set aside. If time permits, we can also start the discussion. Here they're using something called economic value added. But in the context of risk-adjusted return on capital, we'll talk about that as well. But yeah, who wants to start? Someone other than Surya and Parth, some of you, Avik, they've already given their... they have been standing up for the entire class. I want someone else to, stand in for them. Who's going to start? There's a lot of cost of this COVID to all the students, but also a lot of benefits. So you have probably enjoyed the benefits quite a lot in this particular class. So can someone take the mantle and start the case? Ashutosh also, I think, had participated earlier. Someone else? Ashutosh, Parth, Surya, Avik, Sarvesh. Alistair Dawes is the protagonist, says Ashutosh. Yeah, but Ashutosh, someone else. Unmute and talk. It's a case study. Otherwise, we can break here. Yeah, before that, I forgot. I want an assignment to be done by next class. Okay. Again, I'll do a cold call, actually. None of these people who have actually given me answers still late. I want to do a cold call. All these creditors we mentioned about. In India, in October 2020, there was a big, big decision taken by RBI on the mortgage loans. It is something implication to capital adequacy. I want you to go and run through that materials in terms of what the regulatory change was. there's a lot of traction around that October 9th or, you know, September end. That is when the news came out. There's a lot of activity in the markets around that point. There's a lot of materials available in a lot of websites. Just understand what the change was pertaining to mortgage loans and how does it impact the real estate industry. So a decision in taken in terms of risk management framework, how does it have an impact on the real estate industry? Okay, is the question. And I'm going to call one person to answer that particular point in the next class. Okay, so I would urge you to be prepared for that. And any of the people who have actually already given the answers and have participated is not the one which I would want to call. Okay, so please do that. Yeah, who wants to start this particular case? Have you read the case? Who all have read the case? Are you taking the class for granted in terms of, you know, don't care? I am someone who doesn't really come at you strongly. Yeah, I don't want, you know, Surya to say I read the case, because how many times will Surya say he read the case? I'm not doing a in-person coaching or something for Surya here. Okay, I have a 66 member class out here. Okay, just come in good spirit. It's a new year. Who will bell the cat? In the class, you could have looked at each other and, you know, given some eye contact. But here, maybe chat and then say who is going to start. I'm not going to talk. I'm just going to be the scribe. In a case study, I should be scribe. No, I'm not going to discuss it. Of course, I will direct you. But I'm just going to note down what you're going to tell. Or is it that, you know, you all know all this stuff and these are all not required and not worthy enough? Oh, that's not the way the banks function in the country. That's not the way the risk management should be. Or this topic is, you know, it's second year, it's an elective. You have chosen this, right? Okay, one person has mentioned that, I don't want to take the name personally, that, you know, the person has not got the case yet because it's in transit back to campus. Fine. If there is a valid reason, I'm okay. I'm fair in that sense. It's fine. What about others? Ravish, yeah, you have raised the hand.
Yes, sir. So, sir, the case is about the Wellfleet Bank.
And don't raise the hands and stuff. You can start, because I never wanted that to happen. You can start talking in the class, you know, use your discretion and go ahead. Yeah, Garavish, go ahead.
Sure, sir. So, sir, the case is about Wellfleet Bank, which, as you mentioned, is positioned in the emerging economies of Southeast Asia.
Okay.
So their growth point is their corporate loan book, as well as the Southeast Asian markets, and they have some targets in mind, like South Korea, India, Pakistan, and China.
But is it only commercial banking that they are? I mean, is it only corporate banking that they are interested in?
So like around 58% of the total profits were coming out of the corporate banking division. So that formed the major banking division.
58% is from corporate banking profits.
Yes, sir. And 72% assets.
72% assets. In consumer banking, assets were roughly 30% and roughly some 40 something percentage of the profits. So consumer banking was much more profitable. Yeah, if you look at, you know, profits to assets ratio, then of course consumer banking was giving more profits for the same assets that is being deployed. Okay, corporate banking, it is more asset intensive, but not the same kind of profits. Yeah, so corporate banking, consumer banking, these were the two primary divisions of this particular bank. Yeah. Go ahead, Ramesh. Yeah. Go ahead, Ravish.
Yes, sir, like also they in between, yeah, they found certain like they wanted to grow the corporate.
Yeah. So the strategy, the growth strategy is actually growing the corporate book. Yeah. Through growing the corporate book.
So they found two. Yes, sir. So they found two avenues there. So one was the syndicated loan category, and second was the leveraged loan category.
Yeah. What is leveraged loans class? So they were looking at transformational deals to actually grow the book. Yeah, the deals that are in the size of the tune of close to $1 billion each deal is actually close to the tune of $1 billion. So if I did a recent study, I'm actually not, the paper is not yet out. We have the syndications, okay, the loan syndications data from 1998 onwards until 2020, as early as, you know, as late as rather October 2020. The average syndicated loan deal size is about $750 million. Okay. So syndicated loans are typically larger quantum loans. Yeah. What is the salient features of a syndicated loan? Devish, I'll come back to you. But what is a syndicated loan and what is a leveraged loan?
So I can take that too.
Devish is taking it or someone else?
Yes, sir. So I'll take it. So
okay, Devish, go ahead. Yeah.
So basically, syndicated loans is a pool of a larger money where banks share in the capital they'll be providing to the corporate client. So essentially, like also in the case of Usher Industries, the total loan size they were seeking was 8 billion. Yeah. However,
$8 billion or $850 million?
The 8 billion in total.
The entire consortium was there 12 nights, right? They had some 12 banks who were they banking with usually, and the Wellfleet wanted to enter into that particular syndicate, or the group of banks.
Sir. Yeah, to the tune of $850 million. Hmm. Right.
And so, what else in syndicated loans? Yeah, go ahead, Ravish. Sorry.
Yes, sir. And sir, leverage loans means that you are essentially providing capital to the companies which are already quite leveraged in nature.
Not capital. So, yeah, capital in the terms of what the firms are getting, but as far as banks, they're lending. Yeah, they're giving actually loans.
Yes, so capital in the sense that it is capital for the company and not bank here.
Okay, and they're trying to finance. These are firms with already debt overhang. They're already leveraged. They're probably in the cusp of, you know, rating downgrades maybe, but they're investment grade still. But they are actually leveraged entities. They are mature businesses and they have huge loans and they want to refinance it. Like in the case of GGC, I think the gold mining company, we see that, right? That's a leveraged loan. They're trying to refinance a convertible bond to the tune of $1 billion. So that's what. High interest rate revenues, exactly. The reason being that their credit profile is actually weak. And hence, of course, you will charge them more and there is more revenues to earn the higher income. But of course, it also comes with higher risk because these are leveraged loans. You also have to be mindful that your seniority would be lower in the pecking order because they might have other counterparties also which they would have taken the facilities from. So in that sense, leveraged loans are riskier in nature because your seniority in terms of, say, in the default event, your seniority in terms of getting the residual claims will be lower. So these are things to mind. Okay. So leveraged loans and syndicated loans is where Wellfleet Bank wants to enter into. Ravish mentions that. Ravish, anything else?
Yes, sir. So, sir, essentially the bank's major point was that they boasted of their compliance standards since they were operating out of a country like UK. Also, they had internal risk management practices in place. So they formed sort of a hierarchy of risk operation at the top of which Group Credit Committee was placed.
Yeah.
So group credit committee was essentially a committee of three members.
Yeah. So Ravish, if I interject you there, and if I just draw the org structure of this bank, which is only, you know, it is not directly given. We can try to speculate. So to the CEO, of course, you have your CRO who is reporting to CRO to the CEO. Of course, you will have the business units. So this could be your business units, BUs, which is also reporting into the CEO. But you also have something called a credit committee, right? That is somewhere outside, I would say, because there are two people from the risk that is reporting here. And there is one person from the BU who is sitting here. There are three people out here, who is sitting in the group credit committee. And if the group credit committee couldn't take a decision, that will go to the board, actually, right? They say that it is going to the board. Okay, a consensus decision will go to the board in terms of the risk appetite. If the group credit committee is not able to take a decision, they're saying that this entire thing will go to the board for approval, because that will be above the... So group credit committee had the entire power, right, in terms of approvals? Yes or no? Yeah, CEO was mostly out of the process. Exactly. CEO was clearly arm's length away from the process. The group credit committee had the ultimate delegation in terms of whatever is the agreed risk appetite of the bank, they can take the final call in terms of going ahead and approving a facility. If they don't come to a consensus, that will have to go to the board, because that would be outside the risk appetite of anyone within the bank. The board will have to take a consensus whether it should be approved or not. Is it clear in terms of the flow, what is happening here? Yeah. Ravish, you can yes, continue. Sir. So the group credit yes, committee sir. You're talking about, what is right, specific sir. About that?
So the major, like there were mainly two stakeholders involved in this case. One was the relationship management side, and one was the risk management side. Yeah. So like the proposition of sales management team was that if much of the power is given to the risk management committee, then there might be some good corporate relationships they can miss out on having like some rigid risk management practices in place.
So that particular tension is all across the case, right? They're mentioning that it's a fine balance between risk and revenue. So sales is always trying to push for the case to go through, because they're bringing the customer through a tedious process, and risk always tries to tell you, hang on, we can't really onboard the customer. We have to probably ask a lot of questions. And if it is only after waiting, we can let the customer into the system. So in that sense, there is a tension, because if risk says always no to a customer, you don't have business, you don't have any revenues to actually. Utkar says GCC had no upper limit. So, you know, of course, there's a limit in terms of capital, they say. Yeah, whatever is the capital that they're holding, based on the capital adequacy norms, if they had the requisite capital, they can approve the facility. Right, Utkarsh? The only limit was capital. So if they had the resources on the liability side, they can approve the facility. That's what is mentioned in the case. And hence, they didn't have any kind of ambit in which they stopped anything. The GCC had the final call. But if there is no consensus, it goes to the board for approval as far as the deal is concerned. Okay, now Ravish says there is sales, there is risk. The tension between these two is also playing up in the GCC. Is that all, Ravish? Anything else for the GCC?
So second point also was that under GCC, there were like 7 compartmentalized risk divisions. So the proposition of Thomas Mayfield, which was the deputy group chief risk officer in 2007, was that the risks are sort of, they play in an interdependent manner.
Exactly. So Thomas Mayfield was part of the GCC in 2006, if you read the case, for the evaluation of Usher Industries. He actually went up the ladder. He became the deputy chief risk officer, or group chief risk officer. And he mentions that, look, when I came here, of course, I'm in charge of other risks also, but I can see that clearly the way we evaluate risk in the organization is compartment-based or silo-based. But it has to be a holistic kind of evaluation. Right, Ravish? If I understood correctly.
Yes,
that's what that's what it's mentioned. Yeah, great.
So, looking at the risk assessment methodology taken by Wellfleet Bank, they had developed an internal model which could calculate the risk-adjusted revenue as well as the risk-adjusted profits.
Exactly. So they have internal models also in GCC, okay? Or rather, in the entire Wellfleet Bank risk management framework, okay? Internal models, adequate controls. What else?
Yes, sir. Also, the case provides 3 metrics used in calculation, the expected loss from...
which we learned also, right? Expected losses, whatever we learned is mentioned in the case also. Expected losses, and they of course have capital charge, they mentioned, right? So capital charge is essentially the unexpected losses which they are computing, which someone else is giving them the number, it is mentioned in the case, to the business person, that is actually the risk team that would have given the capital charge number, or maybe treasury, that's what they mentioned. So these are the internal models in place. So if you look at the risk management framework within Wellfleet Bank, what is your initial judgment about the risk management in this particular bank? What's your take on the risk management? Ravish, you can probably speculate because you have given a very good gist of what the case is about, as in about what the bank is about. So you can probably speculate. What is your assessment of this particular bank's risk framework?
Sir, it seems that they are like taking care of their risk enough, because they have like risk models in place. Also, they have a hierarchy of sorts in their risk operations, which ends with the GCC in the top place.
Okay.
So they are also following a full process. So they might be hindering the sales portfolio of their bank. Mm-hmm. However, they're making sure that they're taking care of the risk.
But is there any indication that they're hampering the sales portfolio of the bank?
So not really.
They're actually underwriting a lot of proposals, right? So I think the problem is probably the process itself. We'll talk about that. Okay. There could be some operational risk out there. but it is well managed, so to speak, right? Ravish, can I take that as your assessment overall?
Right, sir. Right.
Yeah.
Sir. Yes, sir.
I am sorry. I have to. I think there is something happening. So around my house. So there could be some disturbance. I'm really sorry about it. Okay. Okay, so it is kind of well managed if you want to put a kind of speculative. Yeah, Alpine Pass. We'll come to that, Ashutosh. Yeah. So they're little stringent in their risk management, says Surya. What do you mean by that, Surya? Why do you say they're stringent?
I think primarily because the amount of emphasis they put on being independent while Alistair Dobbs is trying to be part of it.
You're saying that CEO is clearly arm-sync, right? That's one problem. Or rather, is it a benefit or a problem? What do you think? What about Videocon case in India?
I agree, sir. But I think in this case, they took it a little too far because the strategic part is not coming through. It's just the risk modeling.
Yeah. So one thing, Surya, if I may, put words in your mouth also, probably you are already meaning that, is that CEO is the ultimate risk officer, right? Don't you think?
Yes, he is.
CEO is the ultimate risk officer, right? He or she is in charge of everything, actually. They are actually responsible for the risk-adjusted returns. You know, the eventual bottom line is actually a function of even the risk. So in that sense, maybe a CEO is a bit arm's length and, the business doesn't get that kind of impetus, you can say that. But typically, the risk management function, CRO, will have a dotted reporting to the board, okay, to preserve independence, okay? Because, CEO sometimes can actually stifle the independence of CRO in coming to a decision. That is also there. So these are concerns. We'll talk about it. We'll debate as we go forward. Yeah, good point, Surya. So yeah, CEO is probably arm's length in this particular case. And you're saying that maybe there could be more intervention. Okay, what about the case? What else? Yeah, fine. That is the gist of the bank. Ravish gave a very good picture in terms of what the case is. The protagonist, Ravish said, is a CEO. Alistair Dawes is contemplating what should be the future strategy of the bank in terms of the risk management framework. Now, in that context, the case actually takes you through two use cases, okay? Both happening at different time points. One is prior to the crisis in 2006. One is bang on just after the crisis or maybe along with the crisis in 2008, October is when the proposal is brought in. So we have temporal aspect also in these use cases. Okay, we'll speculate what they would have done with these two cases. So first, we'll start with Usher Industries. If you see their risk management framework through Usher Industries, what would you gain from that? What are you gaining about the risk management framework of Wellfleet Bank through the evaluation of Usher Industries? What all transpired in that process? Now, mind you, they had a strategic tilt towards going towards syndicated loans, towards leveraged loans. And it is mentioned in the case that it is typically done by large investment banks, right? Who are the leaders in that particular business? Large investment banks. Wellfleet was not a major player in that. Now, how did they try to mitigate that problem? How did they enter this particular business? Did they have an investment banking arm? Wellfleet Bank? No, they didn't have an investment banking arm. What did they do? What did they do? Exactly. Inorganic, they hired industry experts, ex-IB, personnel, and a risk officer, right? A chief, the group credit committee was headed by Catherine, right? She was Catherine Richards. She was hired from the investment banking industry with a risk expertise, right? So this also was done, both the back end, both the compliance side, the middle office, as well as the front office, the people who are bringing in sales was hired from the investment banking industry to actually facilitate this transition. So in that sense, probably they did a good job in terms of hiring the right kind of personnel to actually deepen this particular relationship or getting into the strategy of going into transformational deals, so-called the big mega deals. How can you talk about Usher Industries? I mean, how do you envisage what happened within Usher Industries? You have the entire credit proposal, whatever the front-end personnel actually gave to the committee in terms of their proposal and what their view was, etc. Okay, what can you gain from all the exhibits that's given to you about Usher Industries? Can someone take the mantle here? And please discuss, typing would be extremely tedious for you, in terms of giving it. If someone can just take the mantle and lead the discussion, it'll be great. Usher Industries. Anyone?
Sir, it was the largest, I think, steel producer.
Okay.
At that time.
Okay.
and their relationship manager.
Largest steel producer.
So Utkarsh, of Wellfleet, they wanted to approach Asher Industry for a long time, but
exactly. Yeah. So Utkarsh, if I may interject you there. So we are talking about a large steel producer. So is it a demand side or supply side? Wellfleet wanted it, or the Asher Industries wanted Wellfleet? What is the direction?
Initially, Wellfleet wanted to approach Asher Industry.
Wellfleet was going for Asher, not the other way around, because they already had the 12 nights, right? Already they had banking relationships, and they wanted to enter into this consortium and lend to them. Largest steel producer. Utkarsh, fine. Go on. What else about Asher?
Okay. So now they were thinking to have a hostile takeover of Zelmon, so that they can gain access to European markets also, and they can become the
Can I say that this is the end use, Utkarsh? The end use of the facility will be to go for a hostile takeover.
Hostile takeover.
Yeah? Fair enough. What else?
And initially, the Wellfleet were hesitant to take Asher on board because of some reputational risk associated with.
So there is some reputation related to governance, right?
Yes.
And some industry, some countries where they're operating. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And because of this, I think one of the committee also didn't pass unanimously the decision to onboard them. I forgot what was the committee about. I think it was reputational risk committee.
Okay, fine, fair enough. Reputation risk is there, one of the points. What else? You're trying to size up Asher. Utkarsh is trying to size up Asher in terms of, you know, evaluation here. Yeah.
Okay, so there was some speculation about what will happen if the takeover doesn't go successfully.
Exactly. So end use, there is a doubt, right?
Yes, whether they still have 50% shareholding in Zelmont or not.
Correct. Fine. And what is so specific about hostile takeovers? I mean, if you're a banker, if the end use is acquisition financing, someone is approaching you for acquiring some other entity, and that is why you're financing. And there is a doubt about whether it will go through or not. Fair enough. But what else about hostile takeovers? Against management of target, right? Revishes is against management of target, which means even the post-closing integration will be tough when it is hostile, because your management will, you know, will not support you, you know. So which means even after this particular thing goes through, this can actually backfire in terms of the takeover attempt. Yeah. In terms of the eventual end use and eventual financials of this particular firm, that is the merged entity. Yeah. So that is something which is of a risk. Yeah. What else, Utkarsh?
Okay. So the risk management committee, they made a sensitivity analysis also.
Yeah.
To determine if the consequence, if the bid was unsuccessful.
Yeah. They did that. They took care of that. So they did that risk. You know, they had kept some fee, right? They had actually also sought some fee, right? The deal doesn't go through, the breakup fee, 10 bips or something.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so they had actually done the sensitivity analysis and actually asked to or mitigated that by pricing it adequately. That option.
Yes, drop that fee.
Drop that fee was there. So that is a sensitivity analysis. So that's a good thing. As far as Wellfleet is concerned, that's a good thing. What else?
And they also did some credit risk analysis.
Okay.
Over the broader issues of risk of integration and corporate structure.
Yeah.
And all the ESG issues.
Yeah, so this is a quantitative or qualitative?
Qualitative.
Qualitative, sure. They didn't do quantitative.
Quantitative they did for the sensitivity analysis, I think.
That's all. So the proposal doesn't mention about anything quantitative in terms of their economic revenue, their risk-adjusted return, etc., expected losses. In exhibits, yeah, they do that, right? In exhibits, it's given. So the risk committee would have, of course, gone through their entire quantitative models. What is that? Expected credit loss, the economic revenue, yeah, expected default frequency, EDF, yeah. So that is a PD, essentially PD. So they got their PD, they evaluated expected credit loss, they eventually got some metric called that the economic revenue, economic profit also, after adjusting for risk. So which means they went through the entire quantitative process. So what do you think about the quantitative process? Are they making money out of this deal? Based on the capital charge, they also had something called capital charge, 2.2 million. Yeah, after accounting for all the risk-adjusted return, what do you think? Is Asher Industries making them money?
Yes, I think in medium term, they are getting some.
Medium term, so it is actually an yearly analysis, right? Because they're talking about, you know, the spreads per annum. Okay, one thing about that analysis, which I thought was not correct, is that they have taken the entire fee, upfront fee, into the revenues. That should be actually amortized over the period of the loan. Huh? there is one thing which can be, you know, improved in that analysis, but they are taking the entire upfront fee as part of the yearly revenue or yearly net economic profit that they will earn. Okay, so we will calculate that, you know, when it comes to RAROC, maybe today or maybe in the context we'll come back to this case also. So they're doing quantitative analysis, and prima facie that looks really good. The proposal looks really good, right, in terms of the number that they are going to earn from Usher. Okay, in terms of the profit that they're going to earn from Usher. What about Usher? Quantitatively, what do you think? Largest steel producer. Okay. What about their financials? It is also given in the exhibits, right? How do they look like? If you are the risk manager, or if you are supposed to take the decision, will you lend to them this particular 1 billion or rather 800 million that they have asked for?
I think they have good coverage ratio. So if you
coverage
see that,
ratio, yeah. In fact, if you look at their leverage, it had actually gone down to very low values last year. It has gone up in the last year. Maybe they are probably trying to raise debt for this acquisition financing. Okay. And they're trying to not issue equity. Yeah. They're going to completely finance the acquisition through debt. That is their motive, right? The entire hostile takeover is going to be financed through debt. That is one risk that they're citing, that they're not really going to raise everything through their money. It's completely coming from debt in terms of acquisition financing. So quantitatively, their financials look solid, right? Usher Industries, I don't know. You should tell me. Is there any risk in their financials other than the end use, which they have accounted for in the sensitivity analysis? Any problem with Usher Industries? Number wise. Volatility, says Ashutosh. What volatility are we talking about, Ashutosh?
So, sir, if we look at the numbers between 2003, 4 and 5, so we can see significant rise from 3 to 4, but then significant drop,
right? Yeah. So, correct. So why is that significant drop happening? Because it's a cyclical industry also. Mind you, it's a cyclical industry also. It's steel. Yeah. Steel is extremely cyclical in nature. So they will face that kind of cycles. You will see that in their balance sheet also, that it will be extremely cyclical. Falling gross capex, says Ravish. Yeah, because they may not have internal opportunities. That's why they're going for acquisition, no, Ravish? So we can see that organically they're not growing the capex. So inorganically they're trying to acquire another firm.
I might have misinterpreted it. It's in cash flow, so it would be increasing capex. That's why it's more negative.
Yeah, so then maybe, yeah, because these are cyclical industries. We're talking about in 2006-07, okay, when the economy was booming. And who's their client? Usher Industries client? 25% of the entire steel demand is coming from US automotive industry, right? It mentions that. Automotives. Yeah. That time it was booming. You know, 2006-07-05, you know, just before the crisis, that industry was booming. So the entire, you know, demand is coming from the automotive sector, not entire, a significant chunk of it, right? So that is a quantitative aspect. They look solid, at least in the numbers that they're talking about. They have pretty good credit ratings, okay? In terms of, if you look at all the S&P, Moody's, Fitch, and even the internal credit ratings of Wellfleet, they are pretty adequately, you know, rated. They don't have significant credit risk. They are a cyclical industry. They are one of the leaders in the industry. And they're trying to consolidate that position by going for a hostile takeover. Okay, any other risk that you see in Usher? Any other risk that you see in Usher? From the perspective of Wellfleet, do you see a risk in Usher? Now that is sizing up Usher, right? You will be doing a holistic evaluation. Not only Usher, if Usher comes on board with us, what will happen to us? That also would be an analysis, right? Usher is big, fair enough. You know, right now the financials look so great. So quantitatively, they look very good. But when we onboard Usher, is there a risk for Wellfleet?
In terms of reputation?
Reputation risk, which you already accounted for, Utkarsh, I've taken that. Fair enough. That is one clearly there. Okay. Mm-hmm. Should we actually go into that particular business? They have certain governance issues. Okay. Reputation risk has clearly red flagged them. That is one red flag. Any other red flag as far as Wellfleet is concerned? Mind you, there is some risk which is beyond credit.
Exposure to the steel industry.
Exposure. Concentration risk. Concentration risk is a huge risk because it's not really, you know, we can't really put a number to it per se. You can't have, you know, PMC Bank holding 74% of the entire assets in one particular counterparty. So similarly, they are saying their strategy is to maintain what levels? 15% of risk-weighted assets. That's what the regulators have told, right? And they have an internal, this thing called 8%, right? 8% is there. Now it is 5%. I think 8% is the threshold for them to a particular industry.
So, right? So their mandate was 5% to steel industry.
5% to steel industry. So what is the exposure already?
5%.
Yeah, it's already 5%. So it is already high in terms of steel industry. Not only direct, they're also talking about indirect exposure, right? Through which industry? Correlation.
Automobiles.
Exactly. Automobiles also. They have auto loans also in their book. Okay, so they have exposed to automobile industries through their, that as a channel. If steel industry is correlated with the automobile industry in terms of their product market, that also can affect their overall portfolio risk. So you're seeing through the entire risk outside Asher also. If you onboard Asher, what is the risk that we are taking? Okay, it's not only Asher's risk, it's also the industry risk. It is also our portfolio risk, and that has to be put in perspective. So in the qualitative analysis, you are also bringing in portfolio risk. Okay, portfolio risk. This can be more qualitative. You have to ask some not some fancy questions. It is not in silo. You have to think the holistic manner. You're thinking it in a bigger picture. Because as far as that particular investment banker is concerned, who is bringing the proposal? What is his name? I think Chopra, right? Chopra, right? He is bringing in the proposal. As far as he is concerned, look, I am bringing in Asher Industries, the one of the biggest champions in this particular sector. We should be ideally giving in. But then Chopra is not thinking through the fact that if we onboard this particular customer, our concentration risk could be actually high up to this particular industry. Okay, so that is about Asher. Okay, so they have done quantitative and qualitative. They don't really give you an answer as in what they did. Okay, what they would have done? What do you think? This is in 2006. Would Wellfleet have given facility to Asher? What do you speculate? Did they give this financing to Asher in 2006? Most probably, yes, says Saish. Okay. Any other answer? Is it yes? Sure? Or most probably yes, you know? More tilting towards yes. I don't think so. Surya. Surya, sure, 2006, when everything was looking up. Everyone was telling, you know, let's dance until the music stops, you know? I think Chuck Prince or someone, Citibank, made that statement. Huh? So, 2008, he made that statement. And we had told that, look, we have mastered the art of controlling crisis. Alan Greenspan mentioned that. We know how to manage crisis in 2003 or something. So everyone was looking all up. We will never have a crisis. We know how to manage. 2006, Surya says, I don't think so. Anyone else to take a call? Now we have a tie. Yes and no, yes and no. Anyone to break the tie? But steel price have already shown drop. Yeah, so it is cyclical. Steel price is already showing a drop. So they are you have got a leading indicator that steel price is going down. So demand is actually saturating. Yeah, it is coming. Yeah, because they are raw material for the automobile industry. So all these stresses are coming in. Cyclicality can be factored in, right? As in factored in how?
Cyclical. I mean, it is not that this is the first time that steel has to go through a cyclicality, right?
Exactly.
It already
exactly.
knows that it is there.
True, but they are entering into a cycle which is actually the downward trajectory. Okay, so you might actually face a lot of stress even as the exposure side. So think about it. They also mentioned about Eastman Kodak, right? What do they mention about Kodak? There is a statement about Kodak by our Mayfield, I think. Eastman Kodak didn't go down. Did someone stumble upon that particular statement? They would have gone with the digital player instead. What do they say? Financials look so great. Nothing, no stress was there on the balance sheet, but there was no product market demand. Okay, they were actually pivoting into digital photography and things. People who actually looked forward rather than looking backwards in terms of models would have actually not lent to Eastman Kodak. Okay, because you know digital photography was gaining traction. They have mentioned that in the case. So if you look at that perspective, Sesh, we're talking about yes. You're saying that you know cyclicality they've gone for. It is a cyclical industry. It's ex-ante known. They have gone through much more you know turf and crest. Okay. So that is already there. So why can't we? Yeah. So that is the logic that you have given. Okay. So it is a tough one. Okay. Sage says you have taken yes. And our friend Surya says it's no. Okay. Parth says no. Parth didn't take a stance. Someone can take a stance. Then I'll break the deadlock. Okay. What they actually did. No, says Parth. Actually, they said no. They didn't give to Asher Industries. Okay. That shows the strength of such a bank, which is not the prime bank, which is actually entering into a consortium, which doesn't have a lot of say in investment banking and these kind of metrics. Still, they had the you know courage to say no to this particular deal. Prima facie in the book, it looked extremely good. Quantitatively, it looked extremely good. But because of these kind of reputation, because of qualitative portfolio risk, etc., they had the courage to say no and stuck on to their risk management policy. And they said no to this particular deal. Okay, and this happened to the Asher Industries. Okay, so I think I will break here. It's 11:30 because we'll have to continue this discussion into GGC, I mean, other one also. And finally, we'll come to a closure in the next class. Otherwise, we won't have time to discuss it. Thanks for, you know, participating, those who participated, okay? And I would expect more people to participate in the next class other than people who actually gave these pointers. So we understood what the risk management framework of Wellfleet is. I gave away some suspense in Usher Industries saying that they didn't lend to them, okay? Now, you probably know what the other result could be. Okay, so you actually can see what is coming, but let's look at the other industry also and see what they did and eventually come to a closure in terms of pros and cons of what Wellfleet did and how they can probably improve the risk management. Okay, it's a different perspective because today biggest problem and biggest discussion that is around is this concept called concentration risk. When you have mega deals, when you have mega exposure, when you have a single AAA rated company asking you such an amount of debt, how much should we give? Okay, actually, in my database, I think the highest facility that was given was some 80 billion to Pfizer, I think, okay, in the syndicated loan database. I was seriously wondering, 80 billion, okay, if something bad happens, you know, the entire bank would actually collapse with that particular default. Yeah, they mentioned also here, 1 billion exposure that can actually wipe out the Standard Chartered Bank's entire profit for a year. Yeah, so they are having a $350 billion book and 1 billion, one deal can actually wipe out the entire profits of a particular year if they go back. Okay, so in this spirit, we'll stop here and then we'll come back in the next class next Monday and discuss, continue and complete this particular discussion. I can try, Sesh. Huh? If there is a snippet, I can try to do that, okay, in terms of what these are and how you love the processes. Okay, great. So let's break. Yeah, sure. Bye. Take care. Yeah, bye.